Denver's juvenile court handles everything from adoptions and paternity cases to truancy and delinquency. And when it comes to juveniles who have committed crimes, the focus is very different from adult court. Judge Brett Woods joins Denver DA Mitch Morrissey to talk about juvenile justice on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Hello, everyone. I'm Tamara Banks, and welcome to Dialogue Denver DA. Mitch, always great to see you.
Good to see you.
I'm so honored to have our guest today.
Yeah, we have a real special guest and somebody that I've known for a long time before he took the position that he has now. He's the presiding judge of our juvenile court system, which is unique in Denver, and it's Brett Woods, and it's great to have him as a guest.
Thanks for having me.
Judge Woods, so great to have you. I can't imagine all the stories you must have to tell. Tell us first, start a little bit about talking the difference between working with juveniles and working with adults. I'm sure there are many differences.
Well, the main difference, of course, is the focus of our court, which is a rehabilitation court. And so when we're working with juveniles who've been charged with crimes, they're not called defendants, but they're called juveniles. They're not called criminal defendants. They're in what is known as a delinquency court. And so if we're very rehabilitation focused with them, we're working on them to try to bring them into the community so that they're not detained. We don't call it jail, we call it detention, and we try not to have them in detention. And we work very hard on that so that they don't see you down the road when they're in the adult system. We try to keep them out of the adult system, and that's what we try to do.
And you've been working in with the juveniles for almost 8 years, is that right?
I've been on the bench for 8 years as a juvenile judge. Mm-hmm. Prior to that, I was a magistrate in Denver County Court, and I worked as a municipal judge in Aurora. I've been the presiding judge here at Denver Juvenile Court for 2 years now.
And so, Mitch, as Judge Woods just mentioned, his work and job really is to try to keep these young people out of your path, because once they turn, 18, and they've committed the same type of crime that they committed when they were 17 or 15 or whatever, it's a whole different ballgame.
Yeah, it really is. And I think that what's interesting about the Denver system itself is it goes back a long way. If you look at the history of the way that Denver treated juveniles, you've got some of the probably most famous judges in the state of Colorado were people that cared about how juveniles were treated and recognized early on that juveniles needed to be treated differently. Robert Steele, who was actually a district attorney and then became a judge and was a county court judge, really kind of laid the groundwork for what we currently have in the juvenile system. Judge Lindsay then took up the banner and really became nationally known for that whole movement. It was a progressive movement to treat juveniles differently, to realize that they were younger and there were differences, that type of thing. We do engage in, obviously, the system. My prosecutors appear in front of Judge Woods, but if you think about it, we can charge a 10-year-old with a crime. Technically, it's a crime, but they're treated differently. We don't call them crimes. But so from 10 to 18, we have this system that is specifically for juveniles and specifically geared around making sure they're going to school, making sure they're getting the skills they need to stay out of the adult system, which kicks in then when you're 18.
Right, and that's pretty important. So the types of crimes or offenses that you see at this age, are they primarily graffiti, curfew violations, or other types of things?
Okay, so in Denver we have a local municipal juvenile court that handles what are called city ordinance violations, so city level crimes. So those would be things like curfew violations, minor shoplifting, like taking a magazine or something like that from a 7-Eleven, those sorts of things. Then the Denver Juvenile Court, which you're right, it's been around for over 100 years, handles the state-level offenses. So we do things like major graffiti, car thefts, possession of controlled substances, all the way up to sexual assaults and robbery. We can even do murder, although that's more likely to be transferred to the adult system than stay into the juvenile court. But in theory, we can, and we have had murder cases come through Denver Juvenile Court. So it's a wide variety of crimes that we deal with in our court system.
Talk about how you start to determine, I guess this is a question for you, Mitch, when you look at the offense and the child, and you say this is now, this person needs to be charged as an adult. Even if it's the same, you might have two people committing the same type of crime, but in one instance, you might still say this person is a juvenile and will be tried as such. The other one needs to be tried as an adult.
Well, you know, that's first, that keys off of the law that allows us to do or not do that. We have obviously a lot of discretion too, but recently, for instance, they changed that whole thing on who could be charged as an adult, and they upped it in age to 16. It used to be 14, and they limited the kind of crimes that we could file directly into the district court as an adult. But keep in mind, there's a whole nother system where we can file on someone in juvenile court, and then we can ask Judge Woods or one of the other judges, consider transferring this individual to adult court. And that is those kinds of crimes that are, you know, usually sexual assaults, real violent rapes, homicides. We can either file those directly, but if the juvenile is young enough, we may have to ask for a transfer, that type of thing. Some of the kids we see are kids that have been in our system a long time, and they have been committing crimes for a long time. They may have been in the gang lifestyle for a long time. And so they're not technically 18, but they're committing crimes that 18-year-olds commit and that adults commit, and they can be very violent. They can be shootings, they can be stabbings, they can be those kinds of things. The good news is that the number of those cases has gone down. The number of just filings on juveniles from my office has gone down over time. We file fewer cases against juveniles than we did when I started as the elected DA 10 years ago. And that's because there are a lot of things out there we're working together with. Our juvenile diversion program, at one point, I thought I was going to have to stop diverting juveniles and not putting them in Judge Wood's system. But we keep about 200 kids a year out of the juvenile system with our own, and we've done a show on it, on our own diversion program. So that's 200 kids that we would pour into their system that then, you know, may or may not end up, you know, at a state facility, something along those lines, doing the same kind of thing. We're all pulling our oars in the same direction with those kids that we think we can make a difference and keep them out of this horrible adult system. That's what we're working for. And we have different levels of doing it. Obviously, when we have to charge somebody, we do. And then Judge Woods and the other judges, they preside over those cases.
So to that point, and looking at it from the best interest of the child, which I'm sure you're looking at, what kinds of resources, you talk about the diversion program, what kinds of resources are there available at your fingertips to sort of approach the system from a juvenile's perspective?
Well, first of all, the diversion program is a major resource that we have and that we use working with the district attorney's office to divert kids out of the system. And so we're grateful to have that. If we are unable to divert them out of the system, then we have our probation office, which is Denver Juvenile Probation. It's a separate probation office. It has its own chief of probation. It has its own probation officers. And they have resources. They have various forms of counseling. They have substance abuse intervention that they can work with. They have education that they work with, training people for school, for jobs, employment, that sort of thing. We have what is known as a day reporting program, where young people can come to the day reporting program and learn skills, and that keeps them out of court or in court less, which is what we want. It keeps them out of detention, which is what we want. It keeps them out of the juvenile justice system. What we want to do is make sure, and the word is, we don't want the juveniles to penetrate deeply into the system. We want to keep them out of it as much as possible and focus on rehabilitation, best interest of the child. We also have to weigh community safety. So sometimes we are unable to keep them out and they have to come into the system further. And then we look at things like the Division of Youth Corrections, which I say is prison for young people. It really isn't, because it's more designed, again, towards rehabilitation, but they are in a detained, locked facility, again, for community safety. And we work closely with the district attorney's office on that to make sure that we are all on the same page and that the oars are pulling in the same direction.
And do the parents get involved in these areas?
The parents are involved. We have what are called parental responsibility orders, so that they have certain things that they have to do. We can send people into the home. We have what are called in-home service providers, which will provide services in the home, help the family regain structure, so that the children aren't running the household, but the parents are, and that the children are being kids and doing what it is that they need to do and getting an education and growing up, hopefully, in a healthy and safe environment.
And I understand you also work in the area of child neglect, where the child necessarily hasn't done anything wrong, it's just been neglected, and so now parents are being brought into court.
That's right. I mean, when I talk to friends, I mean, most people think of the juvenile court and they think of people that are young between the ages of 10 and 18 who have been charged with crimes. And that's kind of what gets the publicity, if you will. But we have a whole other side of the juvenile court, which is the dependency or neglect side. Mm-hmm. That's the child welfare side. And that's the side where parents have maybe gotten involved in drugs, or they're abusing alcohol, or they have mental health issues, and they're not being able to take care of their children the way they should. And so the juvenile court institutes a proceeding called a dependency and neglect proceeding. It's child welfare. The young people may be removed from the parents for a period of time while we work with the family to try to fix the problem that brought them to our attention. We try to reunify the family whenever possible. If we're unable to reunify the family, then we proceed towards termination of parental rights and adoption. And so that's a whole other side to juvenile court. And that's not so much involved with the district attorney's office, although it can be if the case gets serious enough, then Mitch's office will come in and file adult criminal charges, sometimes against the parents. So we have that as well.
I got to tell you, too, we talked a little bit about the history of this court. And, you know, my grandfather was in that very situation. My mom's dad was taken away, basically, from his mother by Denver Juvenile Court when he was being neglected by her. And he was lucky enough to get adopted by his aunt and was raised in eastern Colorado. And I think that this part of this court is so important, because the work that the judges do there, the work that the people in that side of the juvenile justice system, they save these kids' lives a lot. I know they saved my grandfather's life. I talked to him about it when he was alive. And it's something that I think that they don't get a lot of credit for. When things don't go well, ends up being kind of the scandalous kind of, you know, those investigative reporters are out after social services and all of that. But it's an incredible burden, and it's something that this court does extremely well. And I can tell you, every year I see the judges of juvenile court at the CASA event, and what they're trying to do there and what I try to do when I go, they usually ask me to do the ask for money, and that's, you know, let's get a CASA for every single kid in Denver that is in neglect, that is in that courtroom. Somebody that is independent, somebody that doesn't have a bias, somebody can tell the judge what's going on. These are busy people, but we can get a CASA for every kid. That's somebody that reports directly to Judge Woods about the status, the health, all of those things about these children. There's some states that provide a CASA for every single child in that system. Denver and Colorado doesn't do that. So we try to raise the money then so we can have a CASA for the judges to help protect these kids. And that's really something that I believe is important, because those kids too, if they're left neglected, they're left in those homes, they end up in our system. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they end up as victims of horrible murders and things like that, but oftentimes as adults, they'll come into our system as defendants. So it's a win-win for the community.
Right, right. It sort of feels like you're somewhere between hope and heartbreak sometimes. I want to hear more of your stories in just a bit. We're going to take a quick break. We're here with Judge Brett Woods, and you're watching Dialogue Denver DA. Back in a moment.
Life is made of moments. Family. A drunk driver could take it all away. Keep your family safe on the road, because after all, nothing is more beautiful. Mothers Against Drunk Driving. Keep your family safe.
Welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. This is the part of the program where we talk about a legal term. And today's legal term is proof evident, presumption great. This phrase is used in murder cases in which the prosecution will argue that a defendant should be held without bond. Proof evident is clear, strong evidence that leads to the conclusion that the offense has been committed as charged, and the presumption is great that the accused is the guilty party. So this really speaks for itself. It's evidence that proves that this person did cause this crime?
Well, yeah, really what it is part of a bond hearing at the beginning of the case. So we do preliminary hearings where the judge has to find probable cause for whatever we have charged, and first degree murder is the instance where this happens. But we go beyond the probable cause because we want this person held without bond. Everybody has a right to bond in our state, except for when a judge finds that the evidence is proof, the proof evident presumption great. So the judge will actually make a finding based on what's presented at the hearing to say, yes, it's here. I believe you can, you know, the evidence is that strong that you committed a murder. You shouldn't post bond, and then the person can be held without bond. So it doesn't matter how much money they have or how many houses they can put up. They cannot bond out of jail until after a jury has made a decision on if they're guilty or not of first-degree murder.
Gotcha. Okay. We're back here with our guest, Judge Brett Woods. Again, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And I have to ask you about marijuana, since it was passed and became legal, recreational marijuana here in Colorado. Are you seeing any cases with the juveniles tied to marijuana?
Well, it's not legal for juveniles.
Right.
So the minimum age is 18, so it's still not legal for juveniles. We do see possession of marijuana by juveniles. We see use by juveniles of marijuana. We have drug intervention programs that try to reduce that and eliminate it, and we are working hard on that. One of the things that we have seen that has come up a little bit on some of our robbery cases is that we've had some of the medical marijuana dispensaries and the shops that sell marijuana get broken into, sometimes by juveniles who are either trying to take the marijuana or are trying to take some money from there, and then the district attorney will charge them and we will deal with them in court.
Right.
You know, if you look at the, sadly, if you look at the statistics statewide, and this is usually through interviews of juveniles, have you used, have you shared marijuana, that type of thing. We're twice the national average when it comes to juveniles and use of marijuana.
Colorado is.
Colorado is twice the national average. And I think part of the idea is somewhat like alcohol, is this isn't illegal, we're just not old enough to use it yet. Mm-hmm. So if we can get our hands on it, let's use it. And that's kind of a mentality, I think, that we're seeing. But Colorado's juvenile use of marijuana is twice that of the national average. And then Judge Woods talked about some of the other problems that we're seeing, and it's not just juveniles. We're seeing the murders around medical and recreational marijuana. Usually it's home invasion robberies that the homeowner is killed, or the homeowner kills the person coming in, and of course then Make My Day becomes a role there. We're seeing the robberies. We're seeing burglaries of the warehouses, and that's usually where they will steal the product. Early on, in the early days, we did see some juveniles that were jumping into the dumpsters behind some of these facilities and taking out what they weren't selling, what they were growing. You know, obviously a plant has a lot of parts to it. They were jumping in and taking the stems and the kind of things that are not what the user is interested in having, but still can be utilized to get intoxicated. So we had some juveniles that were doing that early on, but I think that we've solved that problem by making sure that the warehouses are disposing of their unwanted products in a way that doesn't impact juveniles. But you know, there's a lot of crime around it. The illegal grows that we've seen usually aren't juveniles, but we're taking in tons of marijuana where it used to be pounds of marijuana, for instance. The quantity of marijuana taken in a seizure now is 3,000 times greater than it was before all of this legalization stuff. So it's caused us a lot of work, and I'm sure it's caused Judge Woods a lot of work.
Right. Judge, what are some other trends that you see these days?
Well, we were actually talking about this during the break. I mean, some of the things that we've been seeing are gun cases, and it's illegal for juveniles to have guns, or if they have a prior conviction, it's illegal for them to have a weapon as a prior convicted felon at the juvenile level. And we've seen a lot of gun cases come across our desk, and that's been troubling. I think it's troubling for Mitch's office. It's certainly troubling for the bench, and we are working hard to try to reduce that. We have some gang intervention programs that we've been working on to try to reduce the number of guns that we're seeing in court in the possession of juveniles.
Why do you think you see so much gun work issues?
Well, they're easy to get, and it's readily available, and so it's just that simple.
Right.
Tom Clinton, he used to be in our office. And they asked a juvenile, how long would it take you to get a gun? And he said, well, it depends. Are you going to give me a ride there, or I'm going to have to take the bus? Because he had it figured out. But it was within a few minutes if he was delivered to the place to get it. If he had to wait for the bus and ride up Colfax, it was going to take a little longer. And that was years ago. There is a lot of money to be made selling guns to juveniles. And part of what we're trying to do with the federal government and with a new program at the Crime Lab is to catch those straw purchasers who are making money off these kids, selling them guns, knowing full well they can't legally have them. And there are a lot of prominent people that do this. They may buy 30, 40 guns a month because they can legally, but they don't have any of the guns when you go and talk to them. They are selling these guns on the black market, and they are selling a lot of them to kids. And so what we're working with firearms and tobacco over in the lab every day to get information about who's buying and selling these guns to juveniles. But also we have a couple of other new technology that are tying these shootings together through the shell casings almost in real time. And so when we have a juvenile that's had a gun for 6 months and used it five or six times, we know that forensically before we even go to talk to them when we find them with the gun. So they may end up with more cases than they had than if just that one juvenile with a gun. If they've used the gun five or six times, shot up signs, tried to rob people with it and fired the gun, those kinds of things. We're tying all those together. And then the other thing that's going on is we have now in Denver, in certain neighborhoods, what's called Shot Spotter. And it's a audio system that is notifying the police when gunshots are being picked up on the system mm-hmm. and telling them where that's happening. And sometimes the officers are getting there in a timely fashion that the shooter is still there, shooting the gun off into the air or still there with the gun. And so we're catching them faster, and a lot of them, again, are juveniles. And the concern with juveniles, anybody with a gun, but obviously a young person with a gun is not going to necessarily use the same judgment that somebody that can legally and that's been trained and has a gun as part of their work or whatever. You know, and that's always our concern, is that juveniles will use these guns on each other or on other people.
I know every case is different, but typically when you find a juvenile who has a gun, obviously it's illegal for them to have it, do they typically get charged as a juvenile with a weapon, or does it become an adult charge?
It used to be that we could file them as adults. Mm-hmm. The law changed a couple of years ago. We can't do that any longer. We can't file them direct, but obviously we would ask Judge Woods in a scenario where we had somebody maybe that has used a gun 5 or 6 times and juvenile, that they've hurt people, they've robbed people, and now we have juvenile with a handgun. We could ask him to transfer that person to adult court. But you know, I can tell you that doesn't happen a lot. It's usually the robberies with the guns, mm-hmm. the sexual assaults with the guns, where somebody actually gets shot by the gun, that we ask the judges to do a transfer hearing.
And I understand that heroin is a trend too with young people.
We've seen an uptick in that, yes, mm-hmm. and that's troubling. We've seen an uptick in a lot of possession of controlled substances by young people. We have problems with methamphetamine, we have problems with cocaine, we have problems with heroin, we have problems with marijuana, because again, although marijuana is legal for some people in Colorado, just like alcohol is, marijuana is not legal for young people ages 10 to 18. They can't have it, they can't possess it, they're not allowed to use it. Mm-hmm. We also see it in our dependency or neglect side, where we have young people that are using, that are not necessarily being charged with a crime by the district attorney's office, but are still in our system on the dependency and neglect side, where we're giving them drug treatment, trying to get them weaned off of the drug, if we can possibly do that.
And we're always looking for that. Our diversion program, mm-hmm. We have mostly boys. We've got to have males that are working there as the officers, because even in our diversion program, we are giving kids urinalysis tests to see if they're using. I mean, part of getting them out of this system is getting them clean and sober, so they're making right decisions, they're staying out of the criminal justice system. So I think from beginning to end, probation, juvenile probation, all of that, drug testing is an incredible, incredible part of that. And, you know, getting the message across that, you know, this is the wrong decision to be making based on the situation that you're in, right. that you keep using, you're going to end up getting revoked, you're going to end up in juvenile court if you're in diversion, you're going to end up in a institution if you're on juvenile probation. I mean, it's a hard message to get across, but, you know, one of the most disturbing things is, and to see the uptick in juvenile court is obviously a bad sign, but when you look at the emergency room, people mm-hmm. that are going there, and you see the deaths right. that are related to heroin, those are all signs that we have a problem. It's a problem that not a lot of people want to talk about, so I appreciate the fact that Judge Woods is willing to.
Right.
It's kind of this nasty little secret, but it is a national problem that we see here in Denver as well.
Just one quick question. We just have a few seconds. How young is the youngest person in your court?
Well, the youngest is 10, mm-hmm. ages 10 to 18. Mm-hmm. Now, generally speaking, we don't see young people that young.
Yeah.
So we're talking usually teenagers, 15, 16, and 17
gotcha.
Is what the bulk of our caseload is.
Well, Judge, thank you so much for being with us. I know you've got incredible work ahead of you, as you've already done fantastic work. Thanks so much for being with us today. Thank you to Judge Brett Woods, presiding judge in Denver's Juvenile Court, for joining Mitch Morrissey on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. We'll see you next time.